Tonight, this is the Clay Terrace Bible Study, or as we like to say, the Revelation Bible Study lately. We're just getting into the book of Revelation, and it's for folks in the Clay Terrace neighborhood and in the virtual Clay Terrace neighborhood. So wherever you are, in other words, welcome on the call. We want to have a diverse study of God's Word and sharpen each other, bring your questions, and details how you can join us any Friday morning, 8 a.m. Eastern. Details at clayterrace.org. That's clayterrace.org. And, of course, we're posting videos also at indychristian.tv. So that said, let me pray us in this morning. Lord, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you for just so many graces you put on us, and the fact you walk with us in our situations individually and corporately. We're watching conventions on TV, we're watching COVID stats, just all sorts of things, Lord, and yet we know you're with us in this. And that everything that you do is for our benefit. And you love us and you love our neighbors. So, Father, we just ask you'll be with us. Guide us by your Spirit this morning as we study your word in black and white about this great love and patience that you have for us. And even some forthtelling, not only about the future, but how to apply it today in Clay Terrace. So give us grace this morning in the name of Jesus. Amen. Pastor Andy Hunt.
Praise God. Praise God. We are following up on a suggestion from Jim, one of the participants here, and it was a great suggestion to go back and look again before we move forward in Revelation at the implications that the Lord is speaking to the seven churches in Asia Minor and how those implications really affect the Church of Jesus Christ right now, currently today. So today, or this morning, we're going to try to get through Smyrna and Pergamon. I want to start here in Revelation 2, verses 8 through 11, as we dive into it. And to the angel of the church in Smyrna write, the words of the first and the last, who died and came to life, I know your tribulation and your poverty, but you are rich, and the slander of those who said that they are Jews and are not, but are of a synagogue of Satan. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. Behold, the devil is about to throw some of you into prison that you may be tested, and for 10 days you will have tribulation. Be faithful unto death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers will not be hurt by the second death. We recognize here in the church in Smyrna, there's a very large Jewish population in this particular city that was incredibly hostile toward the new struggling church. These Christians in Smyrna had to deal with that, and they had to deal with the prevalent emperor worship that was going on. They had members of the local synagogue that made every effort that the Roman government would not regard Christianity as some form of Judaism. And if Roman government didn't regard them as some form of Judaism, then they would be an illegal, unsanctioned religion. So the Jews, again, openly encouraged the Roman government to crack down on the Christians. In AD 155, Polycarp, who was a bishop of the church there for many years, was finally arrested, and he was arrested for refusing to deny his Lord Jesus Christ. He was arrested for refusing to say that Caesar is Lord. And there was a great quote here when Eusebius reports what happened when Polycarp was questioned, he said these words, 86 years I have served Christ, and he has never done me wrong. How can I blaspheme my King who saved me? For uttering these words, Polycarp, the Bishop of Smyrna, was burned at the stake. So we see here in this letter to Smyrna, Jesus warns the church that there will be persecution that they're going to face by the hands of Satan. And even though this church is called to suffer, I think we'll see this church is also called to triumph. And when we look at the indifference that the Church of Jesus Christ is experiencing right now during this pandemic, I think it's going to result in long-term persecution if we are, as a church, not willing to bow down to the coming sexual revolution. I think we're on this cusp of a time like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, where Nebuchadnezzar played the music and they were to bow down and worship the statue. This nation wants us to bow down and worship unfeathered freedom and licentiousness whenever they play the cultural music. And they demand that everyone bows down and worship in its secular debauchery. What we see here, as John writes this letter to the angel of the church, we see that the Lord's divine authority speaks, and that the people here are borne out by this great assertion. These are the words of him, personal pronoun refers to Christ, who is the first and the last, who died and came to life. Now, when Jesus speaks like this, as the first and the last, we see the echoes of the prophecy that we would see in Isaiah 44 and 6, when we see Yahweh declare this. This is what the Lord says, Israel's King and Redeemer, the Lord God Almighty, I am the first and the last. Apart from me, there is no God. So we see the similarity between the two texts here, that Jesus is clearly stating that his authority to the church is the same authority that God had. So, I mean, that's the implication here. And it's clear that he has the same authority over the church that God has, because he is God's authority. And then we see also that he speaks of himself of the one who died and came to life again. He died on the cross for the sins of the people, and he was raised to life for our justification. And by his virtual humiliation, and later on his glorification, he is done. What happens there? He's lifted up to the status of being the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 18 for just a second. Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. I am the living one. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. And I hold the keys of death in Hades. So we see here that Jesus reaffirms the glorious promise, which is important to all of us in the church then and the church now, that he is the one that has been raised from the dead, and he holds the keys to death in Hades. Look at the first thing that he speaks to the church about here. Do not fear what you are about to suffer. You're about to be tested. So he tells us right off, or tells the church of Smyrna right off, do not fear what you're about to suffer. You are being tested. Time and time again through this book of Revelation, we see Satan's attempt to imitate the power of Christ in order always to receive worship for himself. These Christians in the church are suffering economically. They were living in poverty. And the reason they were suffering economically and living in poverty, because they refused to acknowledge Caesar as Lord. And because they refused to acknowledge Caesar as Lord, they were prevented from entering the city's central marketplace or conducting normal commerce. They couldn't buy or sell. And I think, again, you know, I sometimes chastise others, and I need to chastise myself as well, that you don't read Revelations with the Bible in one hand and the newspaper in the other, but there are some similarities. If, and again, not being a conspiracy buff or anything, but there are some similarities to some of the challenges that we might face when it comes to commerce. You know, I went just the other day, three places that refused to take cash. I mean, who refuses to take cash? And three places that refuse entrance unless, not just a mask, but they had to take my temperature. And, you know, if we get to this point that if you are identified or ostracized because you have not agreed to take a vaccine or cannot prove that you have, and then you're not allowed to operate in commerce, that's going to be real interesting to how we come together as a church. And then they were also dealing with the fact of great slander. Now, when we see here, they're talking about slander, we understand that the Jews at this point were active in reporting Christians to authorities and they would be arrested. Okay, what was the charge of arresting those Christians? Again, because they said, they would not say that Caesar was Lord, but Christ was Lord, they were called atheists. And if they and they were arrested because they were not saying that Caesar was the Lord, he was divine, he was the emperor. And that's, again, remember Polycarp, that's what happens to him. But I think here the text is telling us that they understood, just like Polycarp understood, that there were temporary consequences to declaring that Jesus Christ is the Lord in a controlled local government that was satanically inspired, and that they lived in poverty, but yet they were rich in faith. That's why you see him saying that parenthetically. Look for a moment at Revelation 13, 16 through 17. Revelation 13, 16 through 17, where we read, the dragon forced everyone, small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive the mark on his right hand or on his forehead, so that no one could buy or sell unless he had the mark, which is the name of the beast and the number of his name. Now we see this mysterious mark of the beast that we really won't take up till later on in Revelation, but that this was a submission that we everyone had to do to pay homage to this emperor or to this beast and profess other than Jesus Christ as being their Lord. And again, whenever Christians proclaim that Jesus Christ alone is Lord, they will suffer sometimes material loss. Hence, you know, the description here of them being in poverty, this particular congregation. But yet again, they're rich in faith, and Christians must understand not only then but now that the riches that we possess are greater than the wealth of any local merchant or any other group, because our riches are kept in heaven, where thieves cannot steal and where rust cannot corrode. And that if we would trust the Lord all the way through, as he promises here, to the end, that we will receive the crown of life.
Andy,
we see it. Yeah, go ahead.
Question. So are we to read this as Smyrna being poor because of persecution, when I don't know how far away, less than 100 miles away, is Laodicea, and they're rich, they're wealthy. So yes, or do you see this poverty as directly related to persecution?
Yes, I do. See, directly contracting the economy for those who are in Smyrna because they're not allowed to participate because they won't come under the thumb of Roman government. Laodicea had other options that really gave them the feeling of being self-sufficient, you know, with, again, selling the black cloth, also having ophthalmology, the school of ophthalmology, and the salve for the eyes and the other ointment. And they were able, because they were able to be more self-sufficient, they were much poorer in faith.
Okay. And how shall we, well, maybe you're going to cover this right now. How shall we understand this 10 days thing coming up here? If in fact they're already poor because of persecution.
Okay. Yeah. We're definitely going to speak about the 10 days.
Okay.
We see here that these Jews, you know, he talks about these people who said they're Jews, but they're not. The reason he's making this claim against them is that these Jews have made peace with paganism. We can say the same thing sometimes about the modern church. You know, when we try to serve God and this world, then we are making a union instead of a union with Christ. We're making a union with paganism, which we're thinking that we can have one foot in and one foot out, and we can't. You know, when we come to Christ, we have to pick up our cross and bear it, and we have to stay within the parameters of Scripture. Look at Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 14 through 16. They have healed the wound of my people lightly, saying, peace, peace, where there is no peace. Were they ashamed when they committed abomination? No, they were not ashamed at all. They did not know how to blush. What a beautiful term of phrase. Therefore, they shall fall among those who fall. At the time that I will punish them, they will be overthrown, says the Lord. Thus says the Lord, stand by the roads and look, and ask for the ancient paths where the good way is, and walk in it, and find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk in it. We see here that greed always leads to unjust gain, and these religious leaders are greedy people. They promise not punishment because they give their artisans kind of a reassurance, but they have no shame of the abomination, the spiritual perversion, the spiritual adultery of trying to serve another god. And when the city falls, they're going to fall as well. And then when he talks about the last here, when he says, ask for the ancient paths where the good way is and walk in it, we're reminded once again of that word in the New Testament, peripateo, that means walk. Walk is a metaphor for our way of life, our pattern of living that honors God, that we walk in such a way that we please him in all that we do. So we're to walk in a manner that they're walking in a manner, because they said they're not going to do it, that shows strong rebellion against the revealed truth. And when the Church of Jesus Christ, which is the pillar and the buttress of truth, rebels against truth, then everyone falls. You know, when the Church of Jesus Christ catches a cold, then morally, the whole world goes into a pandemic. Because we are the buttress and the pillar of truth. When we fail, of course the world falls. So we see here that these Jews who are not Jews have rejected not only the basis of the covenant that Abraham had, but they're misguided, and they think they're really not Jews through faith, but they're more secularized Jews Jews in name only. So look at, it says again, do not be afraid of what you're about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. This doesn't sound initially like a words of encouragement, but there is encouragement here because they're being told that they're going to suffer for a limited duration. And I don't take these 10 days as being literal, but being symbolic, because these 10 days speak of completion. And that even though they're under great persecution, the Bible, and I think I can say this without fear of contradiction, doesn't promise to spare us from tribulation, but it promises us to be with us through tribulation. Matthew 10:28. Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. The best thing that our opponents can do to us, to take our life, but they cannot destroy both soul and body in hell. And then we are also given encouragement in Matthew 10:29 that our Heavenly Father's eye is on us like on the sparrow, and he values us more than many sparrows. I think when we look at this 10 days and try to figure out what's going on here, that they're referring to the 10 persecutions that began with Nero and Diocletian. This is probably around the end of the 3rd century. And we know that Jesus never leaves us nor forsakes us. We can rely on what Hebrews says in Hebrews 13:5-6. Keep your life free from the love of money and be content with what you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we can confidently say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? And if that is our mantra, then we will recognize that we can trust Jesus Christ unto the end. And, you know, again, I don't take these 10 days literally. I think it talks about completion. Like we look at, you know, 10 commandments. It summarizes the moral law. We talk about 1,000 days or 1,000 years, just 10 times 10 times 10 speaks of the completion of time. And even though right now, we won't see it as clearly until we get to probably Revelation 20, and we will see the great parallels between martyrdom and the first and second death, the enjoyment of life with Christ after death that will come, and it'll take time for us to really understand what's going on there. But we recognize that Domitian, I think he had a short reign from like 81 to 96 AD, and he insisted upon being worshipped. And once a year, the people would have to offer a pinch of incense and come to the altar and say that Caesar is Lord. And when Christians refused to do this, they were killed. They were thrown to the lions, and they were charged with, again, the charge of being an atheist. And again, we recognize that even now, we are never to deny our allegiance to Jesus Christ as the Church of Jesus Christ, regardless. We are to be good citizens. I agree totally with Romans 13, because all the government that has been established by God. And that as long as we're being asked to do what does not conflict with what God has commanded us to do, then we should comply. But if it tells us to do things that God explicitly tells us that we must do, then we must say, I can't do that. We have to listen to God and not to man. And I think we miss something here when we don't see that the promise that is given by Jesus is that those who are faithful unto death will receive the crown of life. Again, we can't go around tribulation. We have to go through tribulation. And that he promises that we will be preserved, that we will persevere, not because of our own strength, but because of the strength that we have in us. Now, when we look at this against, what is it, Daniel 1, 12 through 14, I see that as being more literal. That was a 10-day time of testing to demonstrate to the Babylonians that they had God's blessing. But here I think it's more symbolic, making it apparent to all of God's enemies that the Christ receives vindication by our service, and that we receive victory. I'm getting ahead of myself, but I think it's like Romans 24 and 5 in there that you hear this passage that speaks of Jesus and being spoken to from those who are beneath the altar, who have been beheaded because of their testimony for Jesus, because of the word of God. And they're asking, how long, oh Lord, how long before they are vindicated? And he tells them, you know, just a little longer. And then because they had not received the mark on their forehead or their hands, they come to life and they reign with Christ. Again, 1,000 years. They reign with Christ forever. The completion of that. This is the first resurrection. And I would say the first resurrection speaks to the fact of when we all come to Christ Jesus in faith. And when we come to Christ Jesus in faith, we receive eternal life immediately. It's like John says, is the now and not yet. That we presently, those of us who have accepted Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, have eternal life, but yet we haven't experienced it in its fullness until we transition over to the other side of eternity. So we see here that, again, there's an eternal promise here that he gives life to those who was once dead and now he's alive forever. He, the one who has the keys to Hades in his hand. And then it ends with, he who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. He who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death. The second death is on the second advent of Christ when he comes back. For those that belong to him, and he also comes back to take care of the business of those who have rejected him. So we will not participate in that second death. So, I mean, what do we take away? Whatever Satan does to us, whether he forces us to live in poverty by this world's standards, even if he turns the government against us or causes other religious leaders to slander us, they cannot win. That Satan can take away material goods, but we have riches in heaven, and that we can trust him, that we need to persevere to the end, and that we will receive our crown because we are rich in Christ. And that takes us into Pergamon, which again has a different situation going on here. We see that we're dealing with spiritual adultery here with the harlot that seduces the people of the earth. Again, it has some comparisons to Smyrna, that there is an intense time of persecution. There are a lot of God-hating people in the Roman Empire. They're facing that enemy from the outside, but Pergamum is dealing with an enemy from the inside as well that is enticing them to commit spiritual adultery, leaving their first love. Now, we recognize that the church at Pergamum were considered Nazarenes, and they considered them a sect, and they were shunned because they would not attend pagan feasts in the honor of Roman and Greek deities in the marketplace. And remember, here comes the conflict, because we have the harlot that is telling them to go ahead and eat food sacrificed by idols. But, you know, Paul tells us that that's not the problem. The problem is our being involved in these particular pagan feasts that broke out into orgies and lifted up sexual immorality, that we were not to get involved with them at all. Look at Revelation 2:12-17. And to the angel of the church at Pergamum write the words of him who has the sharp two-edged sword. I know where you dwell, where Satan's throne is. Yet you hold fast my name, and you did not deny my faith even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was killed among you, where Satan dwells. But I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold the teachings of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the sons of Israel so that they might eat food sacrificed to idols and practice sexual immorality. You also have some who hold the teachings of the Nicolaitans. Therefore, repent. If not, I will come to you soon and war against them with the sword of my mouth. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. The one who conquers, I will give some of a hidden manna, and I will give him a white stone with a new name written on the stone that no one knows except the one who receives it. Okay, this image of this double-edged sword here goes through the entire letter. The sword is symbolic of Jesus Christ coming to his church in his kingly office for the purpose of bringing judgment on his enemies. When he comes again, this is not a time of evangelism, but it's a time of last things and clearing up and dealing with those who belong to him and also dealing with those who have rejected him. The sword of Jesus Christ, again, shows his judicial power, the power to judge all things according to his standards. And what the Church of Jesus Christ needs to recognize and continue to believe and promote, that the standard that the Bible sets forth, those standards are just not for Christians. They are for everyone. They are standards that should not be violated. You know, whether a person believes or not, those standards are sacrosanct. They cannot be violated. And if they are, then there's a penalty for it on both sides of that equation. And we need to recognize that we need to stay within those parameters in our behavior as well. And I know some people say, well, you're putting something on people that they have not bought into, that they do not believe. But whether a person believes in the power and authority of Jesus Christ or not, that doesn't change the power and authority of Jesus Christ. I can go over to Neil's house and right there where he has that beautiful window, and I can state to you that I don't believe in gravity. But if I jump off of that roof, gravity will convince me by the time I meet the ground. You know, it's not the fall that kills you, it's that sudden stop. So it's the same thing. This is an immutable law that God has given us, and we need to recognize that we need to stay within that. And the sword also symbolically deals with the fact of the Roman government. Remember, the Roman government had the power of the sword by the emperor to put to death Christians, something that even the Jews could not do. And for those especially who refused the authority and the divinity of Caesar. So I think it's interesting and somewhat ironic that Jesus uses the same symbol to remind the church of his justice and how he takes that sword and justice and power, but also the same sword that is persecuting the people of Christ in this life will be the same sword that Jesus will bring judgment on those in the next life, on the life to come. So we see here that one of those maxims are true. Those who live by the sword will die by the sword. So there's a warning here aimed at this particular church not to be seduced through false doctrine. He says, I know where you live and where Satan has his throne, yet you remain true to my name. You did not renounce your faith even in the days of Antipas, my faithful witness, who was put to death in your city where Satan lives. So where Satan has dominance, where Satan is headquartered in the minds and the secular government, a city that is dominated by paganism, which could be any of our cities at times, and where Satan has placed his throne and wants to build a contrary kingdom. We are in this world, but we're not of this world. And the church of Jesus Christ then and now cannot be tolerant of false teaching. It cannot compromise. He says, I have a few things against you. There are people there who hold to the teaching of Balaam and Balak to entice the Israelites to sin by eating food, sacrifice to idols, and committing sexual immorality. And then it's not an implied threat. There's a threat. Well, let's say there's a promise that if you don't repent, I'm going to come soon and fight against you with the sword of my mouth. So we're going to have to choose a side. There's no lukewarmness here. We can't sit on the fence. We have to be all in. I cannot think of the Spurgeon quote, but Spurgeon speaks of the fact that it's better to be all in with Christ or be all against Christ. That there's no middle ground. You have to see him for who he truly is and believe it with all your heart. So Jesus is commanding the church here to repent, lest they come into judgment. And we recognize here that false teachers in this particular church are not forcing people to deny Christ. They are much, much more subtle. They're enticing believers to deny Christ by using more subtle means. And I think that sometimes we are, as a Church of Jesus Christ, led astray by the subtleness of heresy. When we teach, I mean, clearly what Paul is saying to the Galatians, you know, when we adopt and accept another gospel that is not the gospel of Jesus Christ, then he says, anathema, which, you know, we should be damned. Because there's only, whether it's a Paul or an angel from heaven that comes to us and teaches us another gospel, which is no gospel at all. We have to stay on the narrow path. that leads to righteousness. The broad path leads to destruction, and many will find it. You know, there was a, I don't remember, there was a big evangelistic push from the United Methodist Church, maybe 3 or 4 years ago, maybe it's 10 years, you know. And I remember I had such a problem with their slogan, open doors, open minds, open hearts. And I could agree with open doors. I can even agree with open hearts. I had a problem with open minds. Because by virtue of being a Christian, our mind is controlled by what Christ has planted in it by his word that is going to bring a great harvest. And there are just certain things that we just can't accept or take in. I think we're not to be judgmental. We're still to love the sinner and hate the sin, but we cannot blur it. And too many times we are concerned about blurring things, secular things, that we might have more evangelistic success. Our evangelistic success comes from Christ Jesus and the Father God and the Holy Spirit, who draws everyone who belongs to him. And we are commanded to go and make disciples and teach them everything and set up and align ourselves with them in a way that we live out our lives as a lifetime learners, but that we can trust that the Lord will be with us, that it's not from the power of our suggestion or the power of our persuasion, but it's the power of Christ and the power of the gospel that clearly draws and clearly brings success in every way, whether or not we see that, because some plant, some water, some plant, some water, but Jesus Christ gets the increase. So, you know, we shouldn't, again, try to put the cart before the horse, that we make things happen. We are used of the Lord when we serve him in a way that pleases him, and he gives us godly success to bring those others that belong to him. And that means that every day, every opportunity that the Lord gives us to intersect with a person, to speak to them about the truth of the gospel, about the greatness of Jesus Christ, that we should not fail at any opportunity, though we do every day. I do every day. There's some days I can sense that I've denied the Holy Spirit by not taking the time, sometimes in the effort of even doing ministry when ministry is right before you. You know, you feel like the example in the prodigal son, where they cross on the other side of the road. You know, the first person crosses over that he's in rotation probably to minister in the synagogue. So he sees the victim and he crosses over. And then a Levite comes and he is to get to the temple as well to be able to assist the priest, and he crosses over. But then a Samaritan comes and he sees and he takes and he has compassion. And I think sometimes we skip over compassion and we're compelled to just do perfunctory things instead of understanding that Jesus Christ has a right to interrupt our daily activities at any time, to intervene and to place ministry squarely in front of us, and that we need to stop and react to it in that moment. Someone asks you to pray for them, pray right then. Because you have understanding whether this will be the last time that you'll ever be in their presence. Pray right then. Deal with their issue right then as much as you possibly can. And don't be submissive to the Holy Spirit in all things. when we look here, looking at this deceitful counsel, the teaching of Balaam here, look at the this is probably going to come out of Numbers 25, 1 and 9. While Israel was at Shittim, the man began to indulge in sexual immorality with the Moabite women who invited them to sacrifice to their gods. The people ate and they bowed down before these gods. So Israel joined in worshiping the Baal of Peor, and the Lord's anger burned against them. The Lord said to Moses, take all the leaders of these people, kill them, and expose them in broad daylight before the Lord, so that the Lord's fierce anger may turn away from Israel. So Moses said to Israel's judges, each of you, put to death those of your men who have joined in the worshiping of Baal of Peor. Then the Israelite man brought to his family a Midianite woman right before the eyes of Moses and the whole assembly of Israel. And while they were weeping at the entrance of the tent of meeting. We see the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron, left the assembly, and he took a spear in his hand, and he followed the Israelites into the tent. And then he drove the spear into both of them, though the Israelites, through the Israelite and the woman's body. Then the plague against the Israelites was stopped, but those who died in the plague numbered 24,000. Here we see that when Israel started to worship Baal, they did it in a way, and synchronism here, which I think is dangerous for the church too. There's only one God. You can't serve God and manna. You can't serve Baal and Jesus. You see, they didn't deny God completely, but they also served Baal. And God alone is not going to share his glory. And when we read here again, Numbers 31:16, there were the ones who followed Balaam's advice and were the means of turning the Israelites away from the Lord in what happened at Peor, so that a plague struck the Lord's people. So here, even when we're at the point of the sword, we need to refuse to deny Christ at any point. And we also need to understand that we cannot participate in certain pagan practices with non-Christians, family or business associates in or outside of the church. We cannot involve ourselves in anything that has the potential, which it shouldn't, has the potential to lead us away from Christ, lead us away from the center of his will, denying Christ implicitly or explicitly, avoiding all sexual immorality. And again, there is a thread that is going through all seven of these churches that speaks highly of the fact of the sin of sexual immorality. And again, what an abomination it is in the sight of the Lord. So when we find ourselves the Church of Jesus Christ now being asked to walk the plank, if we will not adopt a society that has decided that there are no boundaries, there aren't any genders, immoral acts sexually, as long as two people are consenting adults. That is not what the Bible teaches. And we just have to be able to stand up against that. Will that make us people who are ostracized or considered the really terrible word, fundamentalist, or whatever, then we have to take the hit, guys. We just cannot do it. Because we see that it has grave consequences. Go ahead, Neil.
Well, yeah, just thought, hey, that's kind of a perfect segue. Okay, so it's Friday at Clegg Terrace or wherever you are. You know, we've heard, you know, on the one hand, you said, hey, you know, God's principles are God's principles, whether you're a believer or not, whether you're the country's leader or not. So I guess the question is, like, to what standard should we as Christians hold, maybe hold our leaders or hold ourselves as advocates for certain leaders? And Lord knows we've seen a couple of weeks of conventions every night and lots of back and forth and so forth. How do we sort it all out? What if we, and in particular, I'll throw out another. Okay, we were in Numbers there, and of course we were in a theocracy in those times, right? They were governed by God and by God's principles and so forth. Along that same time, Deuteronomy 17, Moses is saying to him, okay, now as you go into this new land and you da-da-da-da-da, you know, God apparently has allowed for kings, because you're going to ask for them because you just want them just like everybody else, you know, and he's not at all saying that's his way. He expects to be king in our lives. But as he does that, he says, okay, but here's the prescription for the way your kings should act. And it's in my opinion, it's a great standard, right? But should I expect that whoever I'm going to support in the upcoming election is going to adhere to those standards? What do you think? Not just for those in the room, but even those who might be watching on you know, YouTube or something. How do we understand taking these texts and applying them in our world today?
Well, we most definitely have a challenging choice. And if we believe that God is sovereign, our challenging choice we deserve because of our own sin and rebellion. I sincerely believe that true character counts, not just, and that must be taken in consideration as much as it can. Again, you're not having a theocracy, but you're dealing with not even a democracy, you're dealing with a republic. And you want those traits to be as evident as possible in the one that you cast your vote from. And again, because of the unfortunate limited choice we have in a two-party system, we got a binary choice. And we have to somehow, you know, through prayer and fasting, equate with the Lord which one of these individuals is going to be truly governed more from your will than against it. And that is, I think you have to participate even when you have two choices that are not the best. I think you have to participate, because not to participate is to participate. But then I don't think you can cover up a person's character flaws and sell your soul for your pet issue. And I think the evangelical church in many ways has undercut itself by selling out. You know, it's kind of like Esau taking the red stew. You know, you take the red stew because you're hungry, and then you give away your birthright. And, you know, we haven't obviously taken the red suit metaphorically, but we have given away our birthright for a couple of people in robes that have not necessarily kept up with the values when they had to vote in a way that we thought they should. So we've got some terrible choices, but we've got to make one. And I think we can't just cover, we need to look at it and pray from God's perspective, which one of these men that he would want. I mean, he's going to put in who he desires, and whether or not it's the one we think is best, he knows ultimately what's best. But I think we do need to take in consideration the whole person and not gloss over on either one of just values that they have said that they adhere to and not what we've seen them live out. What is observable? I mean, because, you know, just like I don't know anyone's heart, nobody knows my heart but the Lord. But we can make a decision from what we've observed in the pattern and the truthfulness and the fidelity of that person we're voting for. I mean, in the last issue here is that, you know, we have to trust the Lord that he's sovereign, and that, and look at the history of the church in the Old Testament. We always receive the leader that we deserve. So the bad choices says more about us than it does about the two parties, because we're only given what we deserve. Remember when Israel was right, they got good kings. And when they were bad, they got bad kings. They drove
even that Deuteronomy 17 passage, you would think that, hey, these kings would all be really keenly tuned into that, and that the people would hold them to that standard. And hey, read it, folks. There's only a paragraph there. My goodness, and ask yourselves, how many of the kings met those standards? Almost none of them. Almost none. But today, we even have one side or the other is saying, "Oh, this is a Christian nation. We need to return to our Christian." So they're even putting themselves at obligation. Ourselves, whichever party we're in here, even obligated themselves to live by this biblical standard. And yet then, you know, when the combative rhetoric happens, then people say, that's Old Testament. You don't have to adhere to that. That's a standard for leaders back then. And I've even heard good theologians say, well, it's really a standard for Christian leaders inside the church. It no longer is applicable to, you know, our political situation. Anyway, I don't want to belabor it, but thank you for, you know, that helps. Let me just push it one further. Should I put a yard sign out for one or the other among my neighbors? So, hey, neighbors here in Clay Terrace. I hope to try to apply these biblical standards. So what should I do, Andy? Should I put a yard sign out for one or the other?
Never let the right hand know what is Matthew. I think it's about giving, so I don't think it's way off. But don't let the right hand know what the left hand is doing. You know, secret, you know.
Yeah.
I mean, we're in such a polarized situation here that people are driven to their own corners of extremism. You know, we've got BLM, and then we have, what is it saying, QAnon or QAnon, whatever. I mean, my goodness. Why in the world? I mean, they're just like polar opposites. And neither one of them represent the central idea that they're advocating. It's just amazing. Yeah. And people just run to the, you know, they go on the fool's errand and they run to the extremes of both without looking and observing. Well, let's look at the behavior. Does the behavior match up with what they're claiming?
Yeah. Well, as we know, Scripture said, you know, our citizenship is not here, right? Our citizenship is in heaven if we're a believer in Christ, and we eagerly await us from there. Who among you are not eagerly awaiting Jesus to come back you know, we say make things right, but by the same token, as I think about, you know, around the neighborhood, I'm really not anxious for him to come back and righteously judge just yet. So I guess for me personally, I'm thinking, hey, Jesus, hold up just, you know, long enough for me to get a chance to talk to my neighbors and let them know that you love them and you care about them. You don't want them to reject you, but and you offer this plan of salvation for anybody, not just, I mean, you know, no respecter of persons, but you offer it for everyone. So, hey, I would be willing to offer the person who raised their hand first, offer you the last chance to get in your summary of today and or your thoughts, and then pray us out. Show of hand, who wants the last word? And pray us out.
Oh, I'll bail you out, Neil.
Great. Thank you. Last words or pray us out.
I think it's all been spoken well. I mean, as believers, we're going to face persecution. We've been fortunate here in America, but I'm afraid the heat's coming on fast. And we need to stay steadfast and hold to the truth. So that's all. We pray. Father, I just thank you for this time we can gather and listen to your word. Father, we thank you that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses who have gone on before us. And so many of them have felt great persecution. Many of them have died for their faith. And Father, help us to stand firm in these days, that we will not buckle under the pressure, that we will continue to preach your word faithfully and truthfully. And Father, we know that this is a lost and dying world that desperately needs salvation through Jesus Christ. So may we be beacons of your light. May our pulpits shine forth your word on Sunday. And Father, we do pray for a great revival in America. We pray for our leaders that they will bow their knee to you, confess their sins, repent, and turn to you, Father. Yeah. We pray that there will be a revival in our churches, that pastors will get back into your word, will start preaching your word as truth. And Father, we just pray that you will do a tremendous work amongst us. But Father, even if that does not happen in our lifetime, may we stand firm and not give up. Father, we stand with brothers and sisters through the millennia who have gone through great persecution, been burned at the stake, but have never renounced the name of Christ. And may we also be like them. And so, Father, just thank you for this time. Guide us today as we go throughout our activities. And it's in your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless.